This is the Voice of Freedom. Listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network.
This is my daddy's station. I'm Pooh, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, Eager.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time, and I'm the man that William Jefferson Clinton, the President of the United States of America, named in a White House memo as the most dangerous radio host in America. And today, once again, you're going to find out why. We're going on a field trip, ladies and gentlemen, and don't wander off from your seat once we get you there and get you planted in the bleachers, because right in the middle of this great show, there's going to be a surprise. So, hold on to your hats, get yourself some cotton candy, and a big, giant gobble of Coke, and get ready for the greatest show on earth. Make them get out of your way. Get right over there and sit down. Have a good time.
That's great. An exciting new man from Africa. Never gone. And And on the other side of the arena, in the right ring, ring number 3, the renowned Madame Denver of Damascus, with her performing dog, the Impossible. In the center ring, that incomparable master of fire dancers, the sensation of the ship guard, Hans Victor, and his Bengal Tiger.
Hey, peanut guy, over here. Give all these guys on this row here peanuts, will you? Wow, did you see that?
All over. Over. Ah.
Thank you. Celebrated Houdini. Laszlo will give you the thrill of a lifetime. Bound hand and foot in 1/2-inch steel chains, just loosely enough to ascend the 80-foot ladder now being erected in the right ring. Laszlo will dive into the water tank below. Yes, 80 feet into the water, bound hand and foot.
And now, as Laszlo begins his ascent to the platform,
I must ask you not to make any noise that might distract or break his concentration.
Hey, that ain't Laszlo. That's Slick Willie.
Absolute silence. Absolute silence, please.
Look, there's a shark in that tank.
Ladies and gentlemen, Laszlo!
Thank you.
Stand your seats. Stand your seats.
Ladies and gentlemen, yes, thrill to the grace and beauty, the artistry of that marvelous trapeze troupe from Sweden, the family Svensson.
This is it, guys. The main act is Yep Superb.
you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Members of Congress, I have the high privilege and the distinct honor of presenting to you the President of the United States. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Speaker, Mr. Vice President, members of the 105th Congress, distinguished guests, and my fellow Americans, I think I should start by saying thanks for inviting me back. I come before you tonight with a challenge as great as any in our peacetime history, and a plan of action to meet that challenge, to prepare our people for the bold new world of the 21st century. We have much to be thankful for. With 4 years of growth, we have won back the basic strength of our economy. With crime and welfare rolls declining, we are winning back our optimism, the enduring faith that we can master any difficulty. With the Cold War receding and global commerce at record levels, we are helping to win an unrivaled peace and prosperity all across the world. My fellow Americans, the state of our union is strong. But now, we must rise to the decisive moment to make a nation and a world better than any we have ever known. The new promise of the global economy, the information age, unimagined new work, life-enhancing technology, all these are ours to seize. That is our honor and our challenge. We must be shapers of events, not observers. For if we do not act, the moment will pass, and we will lose the best possibilities of our future. We face no imminent threat, but we do have an enemy. The enemy of our time is inaction. So tonight I issue a call to action. Action by this Congress, action by our states, by our people, to prepare America for the 21st century. Action to keep our economy and our democracy strong and working for all our people. Action to strengthen education and harness the forces of technology and science. Action to build stronger families and stronger communities and a safer environment. Action to keep America the world's strongest force for peace, freedom, and prosperity. And above all, action to build a more perfect union here at home. The spirit we bring to our work will make all the difference. We must be committed to the pursuit of opportunity for all Americans, responsibility from all Americans, in a community of all Americans. And we must be committed to a new kind of government, not to solve all our problems for us, but to give our people, all our people, the tools they need to make the most of their own lives. And we must work together. The people of this nation elected us all. They want us to be partners, not partisans. They put us all right here in the same boat. They gave us all oars, and they told us to row. Now, here is the direction I believe we should take. First, we must move quickly to complete the unfinished business of our country, to balance the budget, renew our democracy, and finish the job of welfare reform. Over the last 4 years, we have brought new economic growth by investing in our people, expanding our exports, cutting our deficits, creating over 11 million new jobs, a four-year record. Now we must keep our economy the strongest in the world. We here tonight have an historic opportunity. Let this Congress be the Congress that finally balances the budget. In 2 days, I will propose a detailed plan to balance the budget by 2002. This plan will balance the budget and invest in our people while protecting Medicare, Medicaid, education, and the environment. It will balance the budget and build on the Vice President's efforts to make our government work better, even as it costs less. It will balance the budget and provide middle-class tax relief to pay for education and health care, to help to raise a child, to buy and sell a home. Balancing the budget requires only your vote and my signature. It does not require us to rewrite our Constitution. I believe it is both unnecessary and unwise to adopt a balanced budget amendment that could cripple our country in time of economic crisis and force unwanted results such as judges halting Social Security checks or increasing taxes. Let us at least agree we should not pass any measure, no measure should be passed, that threatens Social Security. We don't need whatever your view on that, we all must concede we don't need a constitutional amendment. We need action. Whatever our differences, we should balance the budget now. And then, for the long-term health of our society, we must agree to a bipartisan process to preserve Social Security and reform Medicare for the long run, so that these fundamental programs will be as strong for our children as they are for our parents. And let me say something that's not in my script tonight. I know this is not going to be easy. But I really believe one of the reasons the American people gave me a second term was to take the tough decisions in the next 4 years that will carry our country through the next 50 years. I know it is easier for me than for you to say or do, but another reason I was elected is to support all of you, without regard to party, to give you what is necessary to join in these decisions. We owe it to our country and to our future. Our second piece of unfinished business requires us to commit ourselves tonight before the eyes of America to finally enacting bipartisan campaign finance reform. Senators McCain and Feingold, Representatives Shays and Meehan have reached across party lines here to craft tough and fair reform. Their proposal, would curb spending, reduce the role of special interests, create a level playing field between challengers and incumbents, and ban contributions from non-citizens, all corporate sources, and the other large soft money contributions that both parties receive. You know and I know that this can be delayed. And you know and I know that delay will mean the death of reform. So let's set our own deadline. Let's work together to write bipartisan campaign finance reform into law and pass McCain-Feingold by the day we celebrate the birth of our democracy, July the 4th. There is a third piece of unfinished business. Over the last 4 years, we moved a record 2.25 million people off the welfare rolls. Then last year, Congress enacted landmark welfare reform legislation demanding that all able-bodied recipients assume the responsibility of moving from welfare to work. Now, each and every one of us has to fulfill our responsibility, indeed our moral obligation, to make sure that people who now must work can work. Now we must act to meet a new goal, 2 million more people off the welfare rolls by the year 2000. Here is my plan: tax credits and other incentives for businesses that hire people off welfare, incentives for job placement firms in states to create more jobs for welfare recipients, training, transportation, and childcare to help people go to work. Now, I challenge every state, turn those welfare checks into private sector paychecks. I challenge every religious congregation, every community nonprofit, every business to hire someone off welfare. And I'd like to say especially to every employer in our country who ever criticized the old welfare system, you can't blame that old system anymore. We have torn it down. Now do your part. Give someone on welfare the chance to go to work. Tonight, I'm pleased to announce that five major corporations, Sprint, Monsanto, UPS, Burger King, and United Airlines, will be the first to join in a new national effort to marshal America's businesses, large and small, to create jobs so that people can move from welfare to work. We passed welfare reform. All of you know I believe we were right to do it. But no one can walk out of this chamber with a clear conscience unless you are prepared to finish the job. And we must join together to do something else, too, something both Republican and Democratic governors have asked us to do, to restore basic health and disability benefits when misfortune strikes immigrants who came to this country legally, who work hard, pay taxes, and obey the law. To do otherwise is simply unworthy of a great nation of immigrants. Now, looking ahead, the greatest step of all, the high threshold of the future we must now cross, and my number one priority for the next 4 years, is to ensure that all Americans have the best education in the world. Thank you. Let's work together to meet these three goals. Every 8-year-old must be able to read. Every 12-year-old must be able to log onto the internet. Every 18-year-old must be able to go to college, and every adult American must be able to keep on learning for a lifetime. My balanced budget makes an unprecedented commitment to these goals, $51 billion next year. But far more than money is required. I have a plan, a call to action for American education, based on these 10 principles. First, a national crusade for education standards. Not federal government standards, but national standards, representing what all our students must know to succeed in the knowledge economy of the 21st century. Every state and school must shape the curriculum to reflect these standards and train teachers to lift students up to them. To help schools meet the standards and measure their progress, we will lead an effort over the next 2 years to develop national tests of student achievement in reading and math. Tonight, I issue a challenge to the nation. Every state should adopt high national standards, and by 1999, every state should test every fourth grader in reading and every eighth grader in math to make sure these standards are met. Raising standards will not be easy, and some of our children will not be able to meet them at first. The point is not to put our children down, but to lift them up. Good tests will show us who needs help, what changes in teaching to make, and which schools need to improve. They can help us end social promotion. For no child should move from grade school to junior high or junior high to high school until he or she is ready. Last month, our Secretary of Education, Dick Riley, and I visited Northern Illinois, where eighth grade students from 20 school districts in a project aptly called First in the World took the third international math and science study. That's a test that reflects the world-class standards our children must meet for the new era. And those students in Illinois tied for first in the world in science and came in second in math. Two of them, Kristen Tanner and Chris Getzla, are here tonight along with their teacher, Sue Winsky. They're up there with the First Lady, and they prove that when we aim high and challenge our students, they will be the best in the world. Let's give them a hand. Stand up, please. Second, to have the best schools, we must have the best teachers. Most of us in this chamber would not be here tonight without the help of those teachers. I know that I wouldn't be here. For years, many of our educators, led by North Carolina's Governor Jim Hunt and the National Board for Professional Teaching Standards, have worked very hard to establish nationally accepted credentials for excellence in teaching. Just 500 of these teachers have been certified since 1995. My budget will enable 100,000 more to seek national certification as master teachers. We should reward and recognize our best teachers. And as we reward them, we should quickly and fairly remove those few who don't measure up, and we should challenge more of our finest young people to consider teaching as a career. Third, we must do more to help all our children read. 40% of our 8-year-olds cannot read on their own. That's why we have just launched the America Reads Initiative, to build a citizen army of 1 million volunteer tutors to make sure every child can read independently by the end of the third grade. We will use thousands of AmeriCorps volunteers to mobilize this citizen army. We want at least 100,000 college students to help. And tonight I'm pleased that 60 college presidents have answered my call, pledging that thousands of their work-study students will serve for 1 year as reading tutors. This is also a challenge to every teacher and every principal. You must use these tutors to help your students read. And it is especially a challenge to our parents. You must read with your children every night. This leads to the fourth principle. Learning begins in the first days of life. Scientists are now discovering how young children develop emotionally and intellectually from their very first days, and how important it is for parents to begin immediately talking, singing, even reading to their infants. The First Lady has spent years writing about this issue, studying it, and she and I are going to convene a White House conference on early learning and the brain this spring to explore how parents and educators can best use these startling new findings. We already know we should start teaching children before they start school. That's why this balanced budget expands Head Start to 1 million children by 2002. And that is why the Vice President and Mrs. Gore will host their annual family conference this June on what we can do to make sure that parents are an active part of their children's learning all the way through school. They've done a great deal to highlight the importance of family in our life, and now they're turning their attention to getting more parents involved in their children's learning all the way through school. I thank you, Mr. Vice President, and I thank you especially, Tipper, for what you're doing. Fifth, every state should give parents the power to choose the right public school for their children. Their right to choose will foster competition and innovation that can make public schools better. We should also make it possible for more parents and teachers to start charter schools, schools that set and meet the highest standards and exist only as long as they do. Our plan will help America to create 3,000 of these charter schools by the next century, nearly seven times as there are in the country today, so that parents will have even more choices in sending their children to the best schools. Sixth, character education must be taught in our schools. We must teach our children to be good citizens. And we must continue to promote order and discipline, supporting communities that introduce school uniforms, impose curfews, enforce truancy laws, remove disruptive students from the classroom, and have zero tolerance for guns and drugs in schools. Seventh, we cannot expect our children to raise themselves up in schools that are literally falling down. With the student population at an all-time high and record numbers of school buildings falling into disrepair, this has now become a serious national concern. Therefore, my budget includes a new initiative, $5 billion to help communities finance $20 billion in school construction over the next 4 years. Eighth, We must make the 13th and 14th years of education, at least 2 years of college, just as universal in America by the 21st century as a high school education is today, and we must open the doors of college to all Americans. To do that, I propose America's Hope Scholarship, based on Georgia's pioneering program. 2 years of a $1,500 tax credit for college tuition, enough to pay for the typical community college. I also propose a tax deduction of up to $10,000 a year for all tuition after high school, an expanded IRA you can withdraw from tax-free for education, and the largest increase in Pell Grant scholarship in 20 years. Now, this plan will give most families the ability to pay no taxes on money they save for college tuition. I ask you to pass it and give every American who works hard the chance to go to college. Ninth, in the 21st century, we must expand the frontiers of learning across a lifetime. All our people of whatever age must have the chance to learn new skills. Most Americans live near a community college. The roads that take them there can be passed to a better future. My GI Bill for America's workers will transform the confusing tangle of federal training programs into a simple skill grant to go directly into eligible workers' hands. For too long, this bill has been sitting on that desk there without action. I ask you to pass it now. Let's give more of our workers the ability to learn and to earn for a lifetime. Tenth, we must bring the power of the information age into all our schools. Last year, I challenged America to connect every classroom and library to the internet by the year 2000. So that for the first time in our history, children in the most isolated rural towns, the most comfortable suburbs, the poorest inner city schools, will have the same access to the same universe of knowledge. That is my plan. A call to action for American education. Some may say that it is unusual for a president to pay this kind of attention to education. Some may say it is simply because the president and his wonderful wife have been obsessed with this subject for more years than they can recall. That is not what is driving these proposals. We must understand the significance of this endeavor. One of the greatest sources of our strength throughout the Cold War was a bipartisan foreign policy. Because our future was at stake, politics stopped at the water's edge. Now I ask you, and I ask all our nation's governors, I ask parents, teachers, and citizens all across America, for a new nonpartisan commitment to education, because education is a critical national security issue for our future, and politics must stop at the schoolhouse door. To prepare America for the 21st century, we must harness the powerful forces of science and technology to benefit all Americans. This is the first State of the Union carried live in video over the internet. But we've only begun to spread the benefits of a technology revolution that should become the modern birthright of every citizen. Our effort to connect every classroom is just the beginning. Now we should connect every hospital to the internet so that doctors can instantly share data about their patients with the best specialist in the field. And I challenge the private sector tonight to start by connecting every children's hospital as soon as possible so that a child in bed can stay in touch with school, family, and friends. A sick child need no longer be a child alone. We must build the second generation of the internet so that our leading universities and national laboratories can communicate in speeds 1,000 times faster than today, to develop new medical treatments, new sources of energy, new ways of working together. But we cannot stop there. As the internet becomes our new town square, a computer in every home, a teacher of all subjects, a connection to all cultures, this will no longer be a dream, but a necessity. And over the next decade, that must be our goal. We must continue to explore the heavens, pressing on with the Mars probes and the International Space Station, both of which will have practical applications for our everyday living. We must speed the remarkable advances in medical science. The Human Genome Project is now decoding the genetic mysteries of life. American scientists have discovered genes linked to breast cancer and ovarian cancer, and medication that stops a stroke in progress and begins to reverse its effects, and treatments that dramatically lengthen the lives of people with HIV and AIDS. Since I took office, funding for AIDS research at the National Institutes of Health has increased dramatically to $1.5 billion. With new resources, NIH will now become the most powerful discovery engine for an AIDS vaccine, working with other scientists to finally end the threat of AIDS. Remember that every year we move up, the discovery of an AIDS vaccine will save millions of lives around the world. We must reinforce our commitment to medical science. To prepare America for the 21st century, we must build stronger families. Over the past 4 years, the Family and Medical Leave Law has helped millions of Americans to take time off to be with their families. With new pressures on people and the way they work and live, I believe we must expand family leave so that workers can take time off for teacher conferences and a child's medical checkup. We should pass flex time so workers can choose to be paid for overtime in income or traded in for time off to be with their families. We must continue step by step to give more families access to affordable, quality health care. 40 million Americans still lack health insurance. 10 million children still lack health insurance. 80% of them have working parents who pay taxes. That is wrong. My balanced budget will extend health coverage to up to 5 million of those children. Since nearly half of all children who lose their insurance do so because their parents lose or change a job, my budget will also ensure that people who temporarily lose their jobs can still afford to keep their health insurance. No child should be without a doctor just because a parent is without a job. My Medicare plan modernizes Medicare, increases the life of the trust fund to 10 years, provides support for respite care for the many families with loved ones afflicted with Alzheimer's, and for the first time, it would fully pay for annual mammograms. Just as we ended drive-through deliveries of babies last year, we must now end the dangerous and demeaning practice of forcing women home from the hospital only hours after a mastectomy. I ask your support for bipartisan legislation to guarantee that a woman can stay in the hospital for 48 hours after a mastectomy. With us tonight is Dr. Kristen Zarfoth, a Connecticut surgeon whose outrage at this practice spurred a national movement and inspired this legislation. I'd like her to stand so we can thank her for her efforts. Dr. Zarfoth, thank you. In the last 4 years, we have increased child support collections by 50%. Now we should go further and do better by making it a felony for any parent to cross a state line in an attempt to flee from this, his or her most sacred obligation. Finally, we must also protect our children by standing firm in our determination to ban the advertising and marketing of cigarettes that endanger their lives. To prepare America for the 21st century, we must build stronger communities. We should start with safe streets. Serious crime has dropped 5 years in a row. The key has been community policing. We must finish the job of putting 100,000 community police on the streets of the United States. We should pass the Victims' Rights Amendment to the Constitution. And I ask you to mount a full-scale assault on juvenile crime with legislation that declares war on gangs with new prosecutors and tougher penalties, extends the Brady Bill so violent teen criminals will not be able to buy handguns, requires child safety locks on handguns to prevent unauthorized use, and helps to keep our schools open after hours, on weekends, and in the summer so our young people will have some place to go and something to say yes to. This balanced budget includes the largest anti-drug effort ever to stop drugs at their source, punish those who push them, and teach our young people that drugs are wrong, drugs are illegal, and drugs will kill them. I hope you will support it. Our growing economy has helped to revive poor urban and rural neighborhoods, but we must do more to empower them to create the conditions in which all families can flourish, and to create jobs through investment by business and loans by banks. We should double the number of empowerment zones. They've already brought so much hope to communities like Detroit, where the unemployment rate has been cut in half in 4 years. We should restore contaminated urban land and buildings to productive use. We should expand the network of community development banks. And together, we must pledge tonight that we will use this empowerment approach, including private sector tax incentives, to renew our capital city so that Washington is a great place to work and live. And once again, the proud face America shows the world. We must protect our environment in every community. In the last 4 years, we cleaned up 250 toxic waste sites, as many as in the previous 12. Now we should clean up 500 more so that our children grow up next to parks, not poison. I urge you to pass my proposal to make big polluters live by a simple rule. If you pollute our environment, you should pay to clean it up. In the last 4 years, We strengthened our nation's safe food and clean drinking water laws. We protected some of America's rarest, most beautiful land in Utah's Red Rocks region, created three new national parks in the California desert, and began to restore the Florida Everglades. Now we must be as vigilant with our rivers as we are with our lands. Tonight I announce that this year I will designate 10 American Heritage Rivers to help communities alongside them revitalize their waterfronts and clean up pollution in the rivers, proving once again that we can grow the economy as we protect the environment. We must also protect our global environment, working to ban the worst toxic chemicals and to reduce the greenhouse gases that challenge our health, even as they change our climate. Now, we all know that in all of our communities, some of our children simply don't have what they need to grow and learn in their own homes or schools or neighborhoods. And that means the rest of us must do more, for they are our children, too. That's why President Bush, General Colin Powell, former Housing Secretary Henry Cisneros, will join the Vice President and me to lead the President's Summit of Service in Philadelphia in April. Our national service program, AmeriCorps, has already helped 70,000 young people to work their way through college as they serve America. Now we intend to mobilize millions of Americans to serve in thousands of ways. Citizen service is an American responsibility which all Americans should embrace, and I ask your support for that endeavor. I'd like to make just one last point about our national community. Our economy is measured in numbers and statistics, and it's very important. But the enduring worth of our nation lies in our shared values and our soaring spirit. So instead of cutting back on our modest efforts to support the arts and humanities, I believe we should stand by them and challenge our artists, musicians, and writers. Challenge our museums, libraries, and theaters. We should challenge all Americans in the arts and humanities to join with their fellow citizens to make the year 2000 a national celebration of the American spirit in every community, a celebration of our common culture in the century that is past and in the new one to come in the new millennium, so that we can remain the world's beacon not only of liberty but of creativity long after the fireworks have faded. To prepare America for the 21st century, we must master the forces of change in the world and keep American leadership strong and sure for an uncharted time. 50 years ago, a far-sighted America led in creating the institutions that secured victory in the Cold War and built a growing world economy. As a result, today more people than ever embrace our ideals and share our interests. Already, we have dismantled many of the blocks and barriers that divided our parents' world. For the first time, more people live under democracy than dictatorship, including every nation in our own hemisphere but one, and its day, too, will come. Now we stand at another moment of change and choice, and another time to be far-sighted. To bring America 50 more years of security and prosperity. In this endeavor, our first task is to help to build for the very first time an undivided, democratic Europe. When Europe is stable, prosperous, and at peace, America is more secure. To that end, we must expand NATO by 1999 so that countries that were once our adversaries can become our allies. At the special NATO summit this summer, that is what we will begin to do. We must strengthen NATO's partnership for peace with non-member allies, and we must build a stable partnership between NATO and a democratic Russia. An expanded NATO is good for America and a Europe in which all democracies define their future, not in terms of what they can do to each other, but in terms of what they can do together for the good of all. That kind of Europe is good for America. Second, America must look to the East no less than to the West. Our security demands it. Americans fought three wars in Asia in this century. Our prosperity requires it. More than 2 million American jobs depend upon trade with Asia. There, too, we are helping to shape an Asia-Pacific community of cooperation, not conflict. Let our progress there not mask the peril that remains. Together with South Korea, we must advance peace talks with North Korea and bridge the Cold War's last divide. And I call on Congress to fund our share of the agreement under which North Korea must continue to freeze and then dismantle its nuclear weapons program. We must pursue a deeper dialogue with China for the sake of our interests and our ideals. An isolated China is not good for America. A China playing its proper role in the world is. I will go to China, and I have invited China's president to come here, not because we agree on everything, but because engaging China is the best way to work on our common challenges, like ending nuclear testing, and to deal frankly with our fundamental differences, like human rights. The American people must prosper in the global economy. We've worked hard to tear down trade barriers abroad so that we can create good jobs at home. I'm proud to say that today, America is once again the most competitive nation and the number one exporter in the world. Now we must act to expand our exports, especially to Asia and Latin America, two of the fastest growing regions on Earth, or be left behind as these emerging economies forge new ties with other nations. That is why we need the authority now to conclude new trade agreements that open markets to our goods and services, even as we preserve our values. We need not shrink from the challenge of the global economy. After all, we have the best workers and the best products. In a truly open market, we can outcompete anyone, anywhere on Earth. But this is about more than economics. By expanding trade, we can advance the cause of freedom and democracy around the world. There is no better example of this truth than Latin America, where democracy and open markets are on the march together. That is why I will visit there in the spring to reinforce our important ties. We should all be proud that America led the effort to rescue our neighbor, Mexico, from its economic crisis. And we should all be proud that last month, Mexico repaid the United States 3 full years ahead of schedule with $500 million profit to us. America must continue to be an unrelenting force for peace, from the Middle East to Haiti, from Northern Ireland to Africa. Taking reasonable risks for peace keeps us from being drawn into far more costly conflicts later. With American leadership, the killing is stopped in Bosnia. Now the habits of peace must take hold. The new NATO force will allow reconstruction and reconciliation to accelerate. Tonight I ask Congress to continue its strong support of our troops. They are doing a remarkable job there for America, and America must do right by them. Fifth, we must move strongly against new threats to our security. In the past 4 years, we led the way to a worldwide agreement to ban nuclear testing. With Russia, we dramatically cut nuclear arsenals and we stopped targeting each other's citizens. We are acting to prevent nuclear materials from falling into the wrong hands and to rid the world of landmines. We are working with other nations with renewed intensity to fight drug traffickers and to stop terrorists before they act and hold them fully accountable if they do. Now we must rise to a new test of leadership, ratifying the Chemical Weapons Convention. Make no mistake about it. It will make our troops safer from chemical attack. It will help us to fight terrorism. We have no more important obligations, especially in the wake of what we now know about the Gulf War. This treaty has been bipartisan from the beginning, supported by Republican and Democratic administrations and Republican and Democratic members of Congress, and already approved by 68 nations. But if we do not act by April the 29th, when this convention goes into force, with or without us, we will lose the chance to have Americans leading and enforcing this effort. Together, we must make the Chemical Weapons Convention law so that at last we can begin to outlaw poison gas from the earth. We must have the tools to meet all these challenges. We must maintain a strong and ready military. We must increase funding for weapons modernization by the year 2000, and we must take good care of our men and women in uniform. They are the world's finest. We must also renew our commitment to America's diplomacy and pay our debts and dues to international financial institutions like the World Bank and to a reforming United Nations. Every dollar we devote to preventing conflicts, to promoting democracy, to stopping the spread of disease and starvation brings a sure return in security and savings. Yet international affairs spending today is just 1% of the federal budget, a small fraction of what America invested in diplomacy to choose leadership over escapism at the start of the Cold War. If America is to continue to lead the world, we here who lead America simply must find the will to pay our way. A far-sighted America moved the world to a better place over these last 50 years, and so it can be for another 50 years. But a short-sighted America will soon find its words falling on deaf ears all around the world. Almost exactly 50 years ago, in the first winter of the Cold War, President Truman stood before a Republican Congress and called upon our country to meet its responsibilities of leadership. This was his warning. He said, if we falter, we may endanger the peace of the world, and we shall surely endanger the welfare of this nation. That Congress, led by Republicans like Senator Arthur Vandenberg, answered President Truman's call. Together they made the commitments that strengthened our country for 50 years. Now let us do the same. Let us do what it takes to remain the indispensable nation, to keep America strong, secure, and prosperous for another 50 years. In the end, more than anything else, our world leadership grows out of the power of our example here at home, out of our ability to remain strong as one America. All over the world, people are being torn asunder by racial, ethnic, and religious conflicts, fuel fanaticism, and terror. We are the world's most diverse democracy, and the world looks to us to show that it is possible to live and advance together across those kinds of differences. America has always been a nation of immigrants. From the start, a steady stream of people in search of freedom and opportunity have left their own lands to make this land their home. We started as an experiment in democracy fueled by Europeans. We have grown into an experiment in democratic diversity fueled by openness and promise. My fellow Americans, we must never, ever believe that our diversity is a weakness. It is our greatest strength. Americans speak every language, know every country. People on every continent can look to us and see the reflection of their own great potential. And they always will. As long as we strive to give all of our citizens, whatever their background, an opportunity to achieve their own greatness. We're not there yet. We still see evidence of abiding bigotry and intolerance in ugly words and awful violence, in burned churches and bombed buildings. We must fight against this in our country and in our hearts. Just a few days before my second inauguration, one of our country's best-known pastors, Reverend Robert Schuller, suggested that I read Isaiah 58:12. Here's what it says. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. I placed my hand on that verse when I took the oath of office on behalf of all Americans. For no matter what our differences and our faiths, our backgrounds, our politics, we must all be repairers of the breach. I want to say a word about two other Americans who show us how. Congressman Frank Tejeda was buried yesterday, a proud American whose family came from Mexico. He was only 51 years old. He was awarded the Silver Star, the Bronze Star, and the Purple Heart, fighting for his country in Vietnam. And he went on to serve Texas and America, fighting for our future here in this chamber. We are grateful for his service and honored that his mother, Lily Tejeda, and his sister, Mary Alice, have come from Texas to be with us here tonight. And we welcome you. Thank you. Gary Locke, the newly elected governor of Washington State, is the first Chinese-American governor in the history of our country. He's the proud son of two of the millions of Asian-American immigrants who strengthened America with their hard work, family values, and good citizenship. He represents the future we can all achieve. Thank you, Governor, for being here. Please stand up. Reverend Schuller, Congressman Tejeda, Governor Locke, along with Kristen Tanner and Chris Getzlin, Sue Winsky and Dr. Kristen Zarfos, they're all Americans from different roots. whose lives reflect the best of what we can become when we are one America. We may not share a common past, but we surely do share a common future. Building One America is our most important mission, the foundation for many generations, of every other strength we must build for this new century. Money cannot buy it, power cannot compel it, technology cannot create it. It can only come from the human spirit. America is far more than a place. It is an idea, the most powerful idea in the history of nations. And all of us in this chamber, we are now the bearers of that idea, leading a great people into a new world. A child born tonight will have almost no memory of the 20th century. Everything that child will know about America will be because of what we do now to build a new century. We don't have a moment to waste. Tomorrow there will be just over 1,000 days until the year 2000. 1,000 days to prepare our people. 1,000 days to work together. 1,000 days to build a bridge to a land of new promise. My fellow Americans, we have work to do. Let us seize those days and the century. Thank you, God bless you, and God bless America.
And in that speech, ladies and gentlemen, William Jefferson Clinton confirmed everything that I've been telling you, and he told you that the New World Order is coming in the year 2000. He said we're going to have a new government. He said a lot of things. The sheeple didn't hear any of it. If you've been listening to this broadcast for the last 4.5 years, you heard it all. And now you know that we have work to do if we're going to remain a free people. And if you want to be a slave, do nothing. You see, that was the biggest act of all, ladies and gentlemen. All symbol, no substance. And it was directed totally to the adepts, the thousand points of light, working behind the veil to bring about the New World Order. Get comfortable in your bleachers. The circus isn't over, folks. Make sure, folks, that you don't leave the circus early, because as soon as these last acts are over, we've got some more business to take care of. Important business.
side of the arena in the right ring. That wonderfully unpredictable act, those mischievous monkeys of Madagascar.
Sounds like
the guiding hand of Maurice.
Sounds like Steve Livingston, doesn't it? Oh, this is the greatest circus. It's wonderful. Come here, please. Sit on my lap. Want the popcorn, baby?
And in the center ring, Miss Tina and her prancing Palomino pony. Circus over the center ring. That is, you will note, no safety net. And yet, Pierre Gamoulian will walk across the wire to the far platform, where he will drop his balancing pole and return to the first platform on a bicycle. Dangerous, daring, death-defying, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Pierre Gamoulian. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we ask silence for Carlo.
Look now,
at the wonderful waltzing Palomino
go down in history as the day William Cooper took his entire listening audience to the circus. What a circus it was. Well, I got a couple of things to give you here, so listen very carefully. Folks, this is Revelation Day, and you just heard some big ones. Now you're going to hear some more. Yesterday's Wall Street Journal announced the recommendations of a top-level White House committee formed to provide air travel security measures for the traveling public. And this is an admission, folks, and it's probably the only admission we're going to get. Listen carefully. Their suggestion, and I'm not making this up, certain high-risk commercial airline flight operations should consider the installation of anti-missile defense systems on board their aircraft. You want me to read it to you again? Quote, right out of the Wall Street Journal, folks. Top-level White House committee formed to provide air travel security measures for the traveling public. I recommend that you don't ever fly again. I don't. Quote, certain high-risk commercial airline flight operations should consider the installation of anti-missile defense systems on board their aircraft. What'd I tell you? What did I tell you, folks? You see, You only get it on the hour of the time. And I told you that plane, TWA Flight 800, was shot down by a missile just a couple of days after it happened. Because that's how quick the intelligence service works. We knew it then. And I've been telling you ever since, and yesterday I proved it to you, beyond any shadow of a doubt. Certain high-risk commercial airline flight operations should consider the installation of anti-missile defense systems on board their aircraft. And this, folks, is from an airline transport-rated pilot with over 5,400 hours of flight experience. He says the committee further stated the DOD and defense contractor community would be forwarded their proposals for input into cost-effective defensive measures for commercial airliners. They'll probably have chaff dispensers and wing jamming pods and all kinds of stuff. But how many people do you think are going to fly once they catch on to what this stuff is? Now, if you're savvy enough to read between the lines, this basically is an admission that TWA Flight 100 was splashed by a missile. 2 months ago, my friend here had an interesting conversation with a Federal Aviation Administration avionics technician in Lubbock, Texas. And he said, quote, "Everyone in the FAA and NTSB knows this was a missile, and the bulk of the public is starting to figure it out, too. They won't be able to sit on this much longer." End quote. The man had 18 years' experience designing Loran and GPS systems for flight integration, and prior to that worked for the Department of Defense as a contractor on, guess what, surface-to-air targeting radar systems. There you have it again. How do you like that? Put that in your pipe and smoke it. And then listen to this. Everybody always writes me these interesting letters that say, "Bill, you've lost it, you've gone off the deep end, there's no such thing as the Illuminati, never has been, it's a myth." Well, this is hot off the Associated Press, ladies and gentlemen. AP, January 29th, 1997, by Alexander G. Higgins, Associated Press, Dateline, Geneva. Listen to me carefully. Folks, I make mistakes once in a while, but I have never been wrong except for once. When I said Manuel Noriega would never be tried and convicted and put in prison in America because it was against the laws of nations to go into a foreign country, a sovereign country, and arrest its leader, kidnap, in fact, I was wrong. And I was only wrong because I miscalculated how far into the New World Order we are. We're much further than anybody ever suspected. Listen to this. Dateline Geneva, Richest, Mightiest, Meet for Deals and Fun, by Alexander G. Higgins, Associated Press. Wednesday, January 29th, 1997. Listen carefully. It might go over your head. Quote, "Many of the world's power brokers and power seekers will wind their way up a narrow, avalanche-prone alpine valley in the remote eastern resort of Davos this week for 6 days of deal-making, deep thinking, and fun." Headliners at this year's World Economic Forum, which opens Thursday, include Microsoft billionaire Bill Gates, U.S. House Speaker Newt Gingrich, top Russians, and as usual, key players from the Middle East. The group of Illuminati, including top scientists and experts in a range of fields, will have their pick of a bewildering array of meetings, discussions, and dinners, many of them held simultaneously. Now, just in case you missed it, let me read that again. Quote, "The group of Illuminati, including top scientists and experts in a range of fields, will have their pick of a bewildering array of meetings, discussions, and dinners, many of them held simultaneously." Who's going to be there? Well, already named is Bill Gates, Microsoft, and Newt Gingrich, whom you thought were on our side. Well, shame on you. Poo, poo, poo. You were off the mark. Newt Gingrich has never been on our side. Bill Gates might have been in his younger days. Let me continue. For some of the guests, however, the confabs are just an excuse to come. I'm talking about the Bilderberg Group, ladies and gentlemen, whom I exposed in my book years ago. As the organization of wise men directing the course of the New World Order. For some of the guests, however, the confabs are just an excuse to come. If you look at the subjects of most of the debates, you can't imagine most people sitting through them, said British author Brian Appleyard. Many of the government and corporate bigwigs will spend their time outside the Congress Center in one-on-one meetings, cultivating potential partners in a deal or future contacts. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, for example, has blocked out hours of time for sessions with other participants, including Gates and British Foreign Secretary Malcolm Rifkin. In fact, the Davos Forum, which began in 1971, has achieved its biggest fame as a backdrop for high-stakes political negotiations. Netanyahu's predecessor, Shimon Peres, negotiated through the night in a hotel room with Palestinian leader Yasser Arafat in 1994, achieving breakthroughs in their peace efforts. The prime ministers of Greece and Turkey met in 1988 to smooth relations. In 1990, soon after the Berlin Wall came down, West German Chancellor Helmut Kohl sat with East German leader Hans Modrow to move toward reunification. Sometimes differences are bridged within the forum itself. In 1992, then South African President F.W. de Klerk shared a platform with African National Congress leader Nelson Mandela and his Inkatha rival chief Mangosuthu Buthelezi. Recreation also has a place at the conference in Davos, sandwiched between prime ski mountains. Halfway through the 6 days on Sunday morning, those who don't want to go off skiing on their own gather on the ski slopes for organized games. Gather round, children. For most of the conference, though, security takes a back seat to problem solving and intellectual stimulation. AIDS research pioneer Luc Montaigne will talk about the threat of new diseases, while the new United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan discusses his vision for the world. Wake up, America, you've been had. Big time. It's in 1997. We have 3 more years of freedom, and that's it. That's it. I've got time for just a few calls, if you want to do that. 520-333-4578 is the number. I believe it was the last time I looked. 520-333-4578. What do you think about all of this? Or do you? Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, Bill. Good to talk to you. I'm glad you you said that thing about the about the plane going down, getting a shot out of the sky. The how they were saying the Congress is putting out I heard that on the news last night, and I couldn't believe it myself, how they were saying in Congress that they were going to make provisions for the planes to have the deterrent systems on them.
Yeah, how about that?
I was shocked, and then I went around work, and I was like, man, look at this, guys. You guys are stupid. Pay attention. Wake up. But, you know. Anyway, I just want to thank you for putting that over, because I was going to call you and tell you about that, too.
Well, thank you.
Okay?
You're welcome.
Well, take care of yourself, and hey, thank you. I'm glad to hear you back on the air. I can pick you up real good in Jersey.
Yeah, I'm glad to be back on the air, too.
Okay, take care now.
Because you're not getting the truth from all these other clowns that are supposed to be giving it to you, except right here, the people on the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network are the only ones doing it.
Most definitely, and we're trying to do our best to... us little guys out here talking a little bit here and there, and your book is phenomenal, and I try to push that as much as I can, too.
Well, if everybody in this country that listened to this broadcast
would call their local library and call all the bookstores in their area and insist that they carry this book, we could get it out to the American people. But most of you are falling down in your jobs.
Right.
Most people are not doing what they're supposed to be doing. They think this is all going to go away, or by some feat of magic, Bill Cooper by himself is going to save the nation. I got news for them. In 3 years, if they haven't got off their butts and done something, this country is history. Freedom is history. The Constitution is history. You all heard Bill Clinton. And if you need a translator, then this country is history.
Definitely. Well, you know, I'm a single guy, but I keep looking at my niece and nephew who are 4 and 6, and I really appreciate you with listening to her and how educated and intelligent she really is. And I know my niece and nephew are the same way.
Wonderful.
And everything I do, it's like I went out the other day and I come across some good deals on some silver and some gold, and I don't have much money to take care of, but I picked a couple things up for them just for the time when they're going to need it. And I hope that I know they're going to use it for what they need it, because they've got a few people who, you know, like myself and other family members who are very supportive and who, in time of need, you know, my family's number one. And, of course, you know, just taking care of them is what it's going to be all about.
Yep.
God bless you.
God bless you, and thank you for calling.
Thank you.
520-333-4578. Did all you Republicans see Newt Gingrich bowing and scraping to Bill Clinton last night? It's over, folks. It is over. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. Steve from Michigan. Great show this evening. I also wanted to mention that CBS ran a puff piece yesterday as far as how Flight 800 was not brought down by a missile. And then the second segment after that, guess what? They want to put ECM pods on the back of commercial aircraft.
Yeah.
No big surprise.
Yep. The Communist News Networks, the great discredited lying media in this country, and most Americans don't believe anything they say anymore. They have no credibility whatsoever. They're the biggest group of lying, scum, socialist, communist, puke-faced pigs that have ever walked on this earth.
You bet. You get yourself a satellite receiver up and check out the wild feeds going into those folks, and you can watch live and in your own living room it basically being sliced, diced, and turned around 180 degrees right in front of your face.
Yep, that's right.
Hey, another issue, Bill. Guess what? Mark Kornacki is going to be in Kalamazoo on Friday, right here in my old backyard. And I've heard some of the stories as far as him trying to weasel into your conference, and I did post the facts with the caveat emptor as far as listen to everyone, read everything, and believe nothing. Could you just take a few minutes and maybe enlighten people on that situation?
Well, I don't have time. All I can tell you is that Mark Kornacki is not who he says he is. He is not who he says he is. Most of the stuff that he puts out has turned out to be absolutely wrong. We know that he is in some way working on behalf of the New World Order. There is no doubt about it whatsoever. Yeah, at the conference that I spoke at in Michigan, he tried to sneak into the conference. Him and his sidekick, I forget his name.
Don Stattmiller.
Stattmiller, yeah. They tried to corner me in the bathroom.
Oh, man.
Can you imagine that? So, you know, I don't know what they were up to. I wouldn't have anything to do with it.
Well, they burned me for $50, no big deal for a satellite receiver, but in fooling around trying to figure out how that thing didn't work, it slowed me down by a couple months getting up on the network. So.
Oh, they've slowed a lot of people down. Got them spinning around in cul-de-sacs, chasing their own tail, and will-o'-the-wisps, and outright lies and disinformation, everything else. There are a lot of people who just love them, though, and swear by them, and just will follow them into the gates of hell, and I hate to tell them that's exactly where they're going to end up.
The truth shall prevail. Carry on, sir. Great show, Bill.
Thank you. 520-333-4578. Good evening. You're on the air.
Oh, where do we begin? You're killing us with that speech tonight.
Well,
this is to the point of insanity. I got 10 pages of notes I'd love to review with you. But he's just such a bold-faced liar, this president.
Yeah.
People got to wake up here.
Well, You'd be surprised how many people sat through that speech and just got all warm and fuzzy and just felt so good, and Bill Clinton's going to take care of them, and they didn't hear a word he said.
But they didn't. God said the delusion. These people are asleep. They don't understand what's happening here.
Lucifer is the great deceiver.
All of the key phrases he used about the come together, the bridge, the breach.
Yeah.
Man has no idea what he's talking about.
And our window of opportunity will soon be closed. We
did this program. The only reason why any of these programs happened was because of the Republican side of the Congress there, pushing them into certain situations.
You know what the window of opportunity that he's talking about is?
Yeah.
Millennium fever. Everybody thinking that whatever is going to happen is going to be brought about by the hand of God, and there's going to be a Messiah presented to the world. Jesus is coming back. Maitreya is coming back. All of these people who are waiting for a Messiah will not resist the New World Order because they believe it is inspired by the hand of God.
It's true.
And so the window of opportunity is as long as these people believe it, and they'll only believe it until the first day after the new millennium. And they look around and they don't see a Messiah. And then it'll be all over.
I'll let another call get on here.
Okay.
God bless you, brother.
Thank you. And, if they just read their Bible, they all say they believe in the Bible, but they don't believe in it, because if they'd read it, it says right in there that you will never know when he's coming. All of you know that he's coming now. I'm telling you, because you know that, he won't be here. And if somebody shows up, it won't be him. Good evening. You're on the air. Hello?
Hello.
Hello?
Yeah, Richard from California.
Hi, Richard.
I don't know how I can thank you enough for all the great information you put out. I wish more people would listen to what you say and actually write it down. We've been hearing things about militias building pipe bombs and instituting takeovers of cities and all that foolishness. And then idiotic patriot community goes right along with it.
Yeah, well, those
are... They pass this stuff along, and...
Those are not real patriots, and those are not militias. Those are fools.
Exactly. And yet people fax it over to me, and, they put in, two paragraphs of pretty good advice, be prepared, put away some food and stuff. And the rest of it is just all disinformation, and...
Call it what it really is. It's BS.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. Once again, I am truly grateful to you for all the information you put out, because of the information, I have learned what an agent provocateur is and how to spot one, and I think we've got a lot of those. One quick question, what percentage of the people will it take to become aware to stop the New World Order?
Well, throughout history, it's shown that you've got to have at least between 3-5% of the total population.
Well, maybe we're getting a little closer.
Yeah, if you look at history, you'll see that throughout the history of the world, it's been anywhere between one man and 5% of the population. But when populations are concerned, it usually takes at least 3%, and it's never been more than 5.
Oh, well, that's somewhat encouraging. I see a lot of...
Yeah, the American Revolution is only 3% of the total population that participated. The rest of the people either didn't care or were solidly on the side of King George.
I see an awful lot of positive things happening. Of course, the only thing I listen to is the truth as much as I can get it. But, I thank you so much, Bill.
You're welcome. And thank you for calling. I went to push the phone button and push my mic button. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello. Excuse me. Hello, Bill. This is Tom from California.
Hi, Tom.
Well, I think after you playing that speech of Bill Clinton, I think everybody can see why I gave him the nickname of the anal orifice with teeth, because nothing comes out of that man's mouth but total crap.
Yep, you're right.
And listening to the things he was talking about, the things that he's going to...
Oh, he promises everything to everybody. We're going to take care of you in this class, and we're going to take care of you in this class, and we're going to educate you from birth to grave, and we're going to give you this, and we're going to give you that, and we're going to give you this, and we're going to give you that, and we're going to take care of this, and we're going to take care of that. That's socialism. That's communism. That's going to lead us right down the tubes.
Oh, I agree with you 100%, and everything that he's going to fix is something that they've had in their power and screwed up already, and something they had no jurisdiction over in the first place.
Sure, none of that ever works except on a local level when people keep their money and take care of themselves.
Well, I hope the people in the States can get it together, and the States can finally stand up and shove the animal back in its cage of the 10-mile square of Washington. And
guess what? I got to let you go. We're out of time, and we're going off shortwave right now.
Talk to you later, Bill.
Good night, folks. God bless you all. This
A long, long time ago
is the end.
I can still remember how that music used to make me smile.
Unless you wake up, get up off your lazy butt.
And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while.
And help us restore constitutional Republican government.
But February made me shiver with every paper I deliver. Bad news on the doorstep. I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride. Something touched me deep inside today. The music died.
He's talking about Buddy Holly. How many of you didn't know that?
So bye-bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry.
White House memo called me, William Cooper, the most dangerous radio host in America. And it's true. I wield the sword of truth, and that's the most dangerous thing that there is. You're listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network, with studios in Eager, Arizona, broadcasting on satellite GE1, transponder 7, 7.56 audio, and over 700 FM stations across the nation and around the world. The Hour of the Time is also carried on WRMI, Worldwide Shortwave Radio, 99.55 kilohertz, Monday through Friday nights, 5 till 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
This is my daddy's station. I'm Pooh, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, Eager.
We now return you to all oldies, most of the time. Don't forget to tune in later this evening, ladies and gentlemen, for the Jackie Petru program, immediately followed by Michael Cottingham and Quest for Help.
I'm Pooh, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, Eager.
We now return you to all oldies, most of the time. Don't forget to tune in later this evening, ladies and gentlemen, for the Jackie Petru program, immediately followed by Michael Cottingham and Quest for Help.